I invite you all to attend for this webinar on behalf of Mohammad Sadiq AJ Academy of Architecture. I welcome Professor Mohammad Harris, our principal, dean and advisor, and Professor Mohammad, principal, Professor Satish Kumar G, our HOD, convener, and Professor Samad, our design chair, architects and faculties and students to this session of our webinar series. Let me introduce these two faculty from RIT. Architect Ambli, she is a alumni of SEPT, where she did her master's and was a gold medalist. Architect Tessie, who completed her master's from IIT Kharagpur. They're both pursuing, I understand they are both research scholars as well. So I welcome you both for this event, and over to you, Tessie and Ambali.
Thank you.
Okay, just with a brief of RIT and the situation here, this is a studio experiment that was conducted last semester, that is in the academic year 2020-21, where the COVID period and all the lockdown was going on, and all the studios and everything was conducted through online mode. So when we decided about having a project, we wanted something in the in RIT, we actually do a conceptual and much more of an empathetical design studio in the S5, so that people, the students are much more related to what other users want and everything. So we take a different approach for the S5 design studio. Being in the online thing also, it was a very... it was a very tiresome job, actually. We thought about how we could instill all those emotions in the different discussions that we could have. But then what happened was that we actually undertook a online class from Harvard University, which was a which was called Architectural Imagination. And that instilled the spark of this project. The emotion-based studio design is a second edition of a previous design project which was taken 2 years before. I'll stop with the introduction and start with what we did actually. Just a second.
Excuse me, Tessie. We can see
you. Yes, the power went off in my home. I think it will be back. But I hope I am clear, right? Audible?
Yeah, you're audible. Yeah.
You can see the presentation, Anselin?
Yeah, it's visible.
Yes, okay. So, an emotion-based design studio. When we think of emotions, what do we understand? An emotion is a strong feeling deriving from one's circumstances, moods, or relationship with others. It is also an instinctive or intuitive feeling as distinguished from reasoning or knowledge. So it is something which happens at that particular moment. And I think architecture can play a very important part in what type of emotions a particular person or the occupants of that particular building will envisage. Okay, so when we think about designing with emotions, the first step that we'll think is about designing through our senses. So it should be a journey where the narrative pushes and pulls so that different emotions are instilled into the user. But before I go on with this project, I would like to thank two other faculty members, Architect Srikanth and Architect Ashwin, who were part of the various editions of Emotion-Based Design Studio. Okay, so how do we instill the different emotions in our students. So we had two different parts for our studio project. There was a mini project and there was a major project. And I'll be talking about the mini project, and then Ambli ma'am will be talking about the major project. So in the mini project was again divided into five different stages, where first we explored about the different emotions. Then we talked about the emotions in the self. And then we had case studies. Then we went on to the design stage of this minor project. And then a ISM study and a 2D to 3D composition study. Okay, so in the first class that we had for the S5 Design Studio, we talked about different types of emotions. So when we started, students normally came up to these three basic type of emotions: happiness, sadness, fear, disgust, anger, and surprise. But then later on, we told them to divulge more and to think about various degrees of maybe fear or happiness. And then such a type of listing was developed, where different levels of each of the basic six emotions were thought about by the student. So it was, if you take happiness or joy, it has serenity also and it has ecstasy also at two different ends. You have love, you have boredom, you have grief, and you have sadness also. So there are different levels of each different type of emotions. Okay, so we talked about what are the different emotions and how it happens and everything. So next was what we have to develop a narrative where the student will be pushing and pulling the story. So the first assignment that we asked them to do was to write a story of 500 words, a story which was based on their real life incidents. So what happened was that we got n number of beautiful stories which talked about their school elections or the first police station visits, even love failures, ghosts, hate. It was there were traumatic stories also, like parents' death, of sickness, where some students were close to their deathbeds, and stories of snakes. We are a campus of 87 acres with lots of trees, and snakes is always a part of the story in RIT. It was stories of pets, of interviews, of accidents, of traveling alone and having that high of reaching a particular destination. So it was, we could actually understand the students also much more better when they starting talking about their real life incidences. So we actually asked each of them to present those stories also, so that they could be much more vocal about their emotions and what all they had to go through when they were part of that particular incident. So after that, the next step that we took was we asked them to decipher the various emotions that they would have gone, and as they would have gone, in the order that they would have felt that. So this is a sheet of Abhirami, and this is the story of her first visit to a hospital, to a police station. We should imagine that in a 500 word story, there will be a lot of emotions, and those all emotions might not be able to be included in the design process. So what we did was we asked them to cut it down or club it down to five or six major emotions, so that they could actually explain those emotions. So mapping of the emotions was the second step of the design process. So different students mapped it out differently, and we can see that being it a real life story, it was not like the same emotions come in and then they go to a different emotions, but many different types of emotions came up and down. So you can see that this is a diagram by Karthika, where it's excitement first, and then there is sadness, and then there is happiness again, and then grief, and then fear, and then proud. So various positive and negative emotions occurred almost alternatively, and then that was how it was mapped. You can see that anxiety, confusion, fear, hope, amusement, relief, and So different type of students, as they had 40 different, we have 40 in a studio, so 40 different students came out with 40 different stories and 40 different mapping of emotions. And then what happened is what? Many different type of students expressed it also differently. Some wrote it in lines, some wrote it as cartoons also, some had just words, and some did it graphically. So their creativity and everything also jumped in on how to express those emotions actually graphically. And then the next thing is was how do you make the students understand how to convey emotions in architecture. So as this would be a hypothetical project, we also actually we did not find these case studies. It was part of the online course, the architectural imagination course by Harvard, where those faculty members talked about these two projects, the Cuneo Monument by Aldo Rossi and the Cenotaph to Newton by architect Etienne Louis Boli. Both these case studies are hypothetical projects, and they have used very simple forms to invoke the various types of emotions for each of this project. So I'll give you a brief of the project. The Cuneo Monument was to stand is a monument for a particular war that was held in that particular city, and it was to be stand at the foot of the Bowes Mountains, where heroic battles were fought during the war. It, as you can see, it consists of a cube. It is a cuboid, and it has 12 meters side, and there are a flight of steps. Just a second. Okay, so you can see that there is a flight of steps. Okay, I'll change the color. Okay, you can see that it is a cuboid, a 12 meter cuboid, and the person or the visitor has to first ascend a flight of steps, and then you come to almost the midsection of the cuboid, and you have a viewing platform, and there is a small slit window from which you have a view to the battleground of that particular war. And in the Cuneo project, the architect Aldo Rossi is exploiting a different type of architecture, an architecture which will reflect the city's past without replicating specific buildings. And it can be seen as a contribution about how city's architecture would transform in the contemporary times. It acts as a memory of an historical event, but it requires the visitors or the viewers to think about the past also, but engage in a sensory experience through the memorial, but through an architecture which is not historical, but which is very modern and which is very contemporary. So this is the monument, this is a hypothetical project and a monument by Aldo Rossi. So this was one of the projects. The next project was the Cenotaph to Newton by architect Etienne Louis Boli. The thing is that these two projects are very different in scale. The first one is a 12 meter cuboid. The next one is a 150 meter radii sphere. So the scale of the project is very different, but we can see that one is a cuboid and the other is a sphere. Very simple solids or very simple forms have been taken to generate very difficult ideas. So the Cenotaph is a poetic homage to Sir Isaac Newton, and in the design, Boli type, the architect, he's an academician more than an architect, and he tries to reject the Vitruvian notion of architecture, which is the art of building. He says that architecture is not the art of building, but it is a product of the mind. It is the process of creation, and that is what constitutes architecture. So his architecture is very spatial, and you can see that he tries to give a very above earth image to Sir Isaac Newton also, and you can see that this interior globe portion in that particular case at the bottom of which lies the tomb of Sir Isaac Newton, and this interior sphere space creates a very different interior environment. When there is day outside, it will have night inside, and the exterior surface of the sphere has small holes correctly positioned as the position of different stars and different planets, and there were small holes poked in that sphere so that when one enters that sphere in the daytime, you have a very night-like experience, and in the nighttime when it is night outside, the particular sphere was illuminated by a very big luminaire, and it would be daylight inside. So a very different concept in both of these case studies, and we had a very long discussion with the students about how simple forms could evoke different types of emotions, how stairs could be used not only as a means of going up and down, but also as a means of expressing some type of emotion. So these were the case studies that were talked about, and then you can see the design sheets, but this is not a one-day process. It was many different iterations and talking to them about how each of the emotions that they had inculcated in themselves, how that could be expressed onto different forms and shapes, and we tried to see that they do not go into very different types of very complex solids and everything. So this is one of the project. This is a cubeoid, and the thing is that we gave them a 20 by 20 hypothetical site, and they could imagine the context of that site, because for some students they had personal journeys as their stories. So it was about going into mountains or going into seas and lakes, so they could have water or they could have a mountainous context also, that is how you can see that different students came out with very different designs. We gave the design name called Space with a Story. So each of these spaces had to tell their stories, had to imbibe the emotions that each of their stories had tried to be depicted. Okay, so you can see different stories and different types of projects. Some came up with a little bit more complex projects, helical shapes and these different types of rooms and everything, roofs. Okay, so circle mostly, or a square or a rectangle and everything. And so in the design process also, when they did have their jury, they tried to explain how different spaces could tell the different emotions. As you can see in this design, the first portion talks about the path of joy, and then the second portion talks about suffocating steps, and then the third space talks about happiness, and then there is a darkness of grief. You can see that the sizes and the scales of the shapes are also changing to accommodate the different emotions that they are talking about. And then the fifth portion talks about fear, and then the sixth the scale changes, and the sixth portion talks about the satisfying proud. This Kartika had the story of getting her driving license, and there were different components in her story, and that is how this space comes into it. So different students took out different spaces and different take to the different emotions. So that is this. And so so this is the end of the minor project. But next we realize that when we go for a major project, when a bigger larger community has to be addressed, they cannot focus on their own particular emotions. They have started thinking about how different emotions come into each of us and how it can be portrayed. But we thought that when it has to be a bigger project, the forms will also be much more complicated, and having an ISM study will let them understand how master architects have taken up forms and how they derive, because this is a public architecture, and we had in mind a public architecture. Architect Emily will tell you what was our final project. And so we decided about having a ISM study. So we took five different types of isms. That is, we had expressionism, we had structuralism, we had parametricism, we had brutalism, and then we had deconstructivism. We had five different types of isms. So at the first stage, what we did was that we divided, we have 40 in class, so we divided them into five different groups. So each group had eight different students. And these eight different students tried to understand these particular isms. They did various case studies about each of these isms, and then they realized that certain buildings fell into two different types of isms also. So we asked them to demarcate the features, or we asked them to analyze those isms and to build up maybe 15 or 20 features which would say that, okay, if a certain building has these type of features, then it can be said to be falling under that particular type of ism. So as you can see that this is about deconstructivism. The student Matthew has 17 different types of principles. So he goes on with fragmentation, and then abstract in form, non-lectinear spaces. He even talks about the influence with minimalism and cubism also, and it talks about non-dominance of right angles and cubes, and more use of diagonals. So they tried to develop principles for each of these isms. We can have a second example also. So this talks about expressionism. Expressionism is a very, I think it was one of the most difficult isms, because expressionism was about an architect's basic idea and how and that particular architect takes stand for that particular object. So you can see that distortion of form for emotional effect. And there's a subordination of realism and much more of a stylistic expressionism, much more of symbolism. And these students tried to put in the principles for each type of isms. So, but the thing is that this was theoretical. And so we were like, okay, how do we understand that they have actually understood all those isms? So what we did was that we again shuffled all these groups, and we made a different group. We made eight groups wherein there was student from each of these isms. So group one will have a student from expressionism, structuralism, deconstructivism, parametricism, and brutalism. So we had eight different groups, and what we did was we gave them a simple 2D composition, which was made up of triangles, circles, which was made up of a single triangle, a circle, and a square. But they could use different iterations of these three different shapes. And we asked them to develop that 2D image to a 3D image using the principles of any of these isms. So first we asked the group to do each of those isms as a group, and then the student could develop upon which particular ism they could develop. Certain students followed the same ism that they had in the group that they had in the first group itself, but certain students, when they came up with five different isms, when they came up together as a group, and when they discussed about the different isms together, and when they did the 2D to 3D thing, they realized that maybe they could have a different ism. And then this is the 2D to 3D construction that they did. And you can, the first one is deconstructivism. And then you can see the expressionist thing also. I'll show you other examples also. Some had very, very amazing concepts also, like a sinking ship. And then you can see the other one also. Next one, and then you can see that the complexity is increasing as the design progresses, and the basic forms that were utilized in the mini project was getting broken up, and that was getting more complicated with more complicated forms. And in the structuralism was actually, you can see that it's about one and zero, the binary concept of being of having equal open and closed, and that is how structuralism goes about. And then Heifer's expressionism, it talks about of a phoenix rising from its ashes, and that's how she takes about the concept for that particular 3D project. And then different students had different expressions. Okay, so this is where I stop. So a review to what the minor project was. We talked about the different emotions in each of the students, and then we talked about particular stories in their life incidents, and then we asked them to map those emotions, restricting it to 5 or 6 so they could take it further. And then we asked them to design a small space, a 20 to 20 site, where the context was dependent upon them, on about how they wanted to take it. And then finally the ism study and the 2D to 3D composition study. Okay, so here I'll stop and I'll pass on the mic to Architect Ambali.
Thank you, Tezi ma'am. So I'll continue with the major project. Just a minute. I believe the screen is visible.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. So once the stage is like set through different kind of experiments, studio experiments, and with minor projects, we started with the major project. Because the whole studio was related to emotions, at this time, the best option or the best thing that students can relate is COVID situation, because the psychological impact of COVID on a young generation is easily comprehended by the youth, because most of them were going through that phase. And the major project was decided as decided as a COVID memorial or something. We actually started with the idea like, the major project should be something related to COVID. We haven't decided whether it should be a memorial or a hospital or something, but the project should be related to COVID. And then we started with a group discussion among the students. There were 3 or 4 sessions of discussion sessions, where these questions were like opened up, what kind of building should be, like, is it a memorial, or it should be a hospital or museum, or just a community space? So that was the first question. And if it is a memorial, should it be in the memory of COVID warriors or COVID martyrs, or is it for the common man? So then there is another major issue was like, what should be the scale of project? Should it be a local scale project for the local community, or a national scale, or is it an is it a global memorial, global scale memorial, and for whom it should be decided, designed, and where it should be located? So these were all like open questions. We haven't decided from faculty side. We haven't decided anything at first, and just gave it to students. We asked the students to think about it and reach it a common decision. So after long sessions of discussions, a few things were like decided in common, like the scale of the project. We decided that it should be a national level COVID memorial. Then the site was decided and in common, but other things like is it for in memory of whom, or what type of building, so all that is given to the discretion of individual students. The only one condition was like hospital was deleted from that list because to comply with the syllabus norms. Other than that, we gave options to the students to select their own individual building types. And the design process is like same like other studios, but only thing is that we added the results from the previous experiments to each stage. So there is the site selection and conduct study, the developing the design program, case studies, concept and form development, and to the final design. Due to the online class, few of the these stages were conducted digitally or virtually. Other than that, the process is similar. So first is like site selection. When the discussion was open to the students, the major ideas came up were like it should be a national monument and it should be located in the national capital. That time Maharashtra was on the top of the list. So some students argued that it should be located in Mumbai, especially in Dharavi, because COVID has the impact of COVID is maximum in Maharashtra. And the third option was like it should be located in Kerala, because Kerala model of fighting COVID was much acclaimed that time. So we had long discussion on these three options, and finally Delhi is decided because being the national capital, it should being a national level memorial, it should be located at national capital was the argument. And the site selected is like is also the most one of the most controversial sites as of now. That is the end of one edge of Central Vista project. So the site is of specific importance, and that is something the best site the students could get, a student could get in their academy. So we selected that site because of a few reasons. First thing is the presence of a strong axial geometry, and the central and the design. The site has a particular design language, first by the Lutyens Delhi, and then defined by Bimal Patel's Central Vista project. So how the student react or respond to that existing context is very important. Second is this presence of a war memorial. Just opposite to the site was a war memorial. So the memorial, the COVID memorial, also represents India's fight against COVID. So the and already there is a proposal for few museums in that Central Vista project. So we selected that site in Delhi, and these were some of the site analysis and context study sheets. Okay, so second question was like, what should be the design program? So the students were given their own freedom to select their own projects. Some decided to work on a memorial plus skill development center. So the memorial was kind of common to all the students. and other than that they can decide what should be added. So some said the unemployment is the greatest effect of COVID on the young generation of India, so we should design a skill development center. Some decided on a pandemic care center plus memorial, and then awareness museum. Then museum was majority of the students selected a museum. Then some decided on a prayer space or a place for grief, expressing grief. Like that, a variety of projects came up. The common thing was like all the all these projects have common, what they have common is like the importance of emotions in that particular building type. Well, just like the place for grief and prayers, etc. Then they selected case studies. The case studies were also selected based on their selected building type. Those who selected museum did museum case studies. Actually, the virtual classroom gave them like opened up the horizons, and they started searching more and more for international architects. So very good case studies were carried out. And again, the common thing about these case studies is like they all gave importance to emotions in design. So like some examples were like Angie Reddy Memorial and the Jewish Museum in Berlin, the Denver Art Museum, Maya Somaya Library, Peace and Reconciliation Center in Bogota. So they suddenly started talking about the international case studies and global architects, and how these architects used emotion as a design element. After the case studies, they started with the foam development. So once, because of the minor project, they were like somewhat they had an idea how to develop a foam based on a particular ism, and then in addition they have to add the emotion to that foam, particular foam. So they worked on both sides, like one is the emotion and one is a style in a particular ism or style in architecture. So for example, like Christina, what she did is like the COVID fragmented or fractured everything around us, and there is still hope, and it is the there is a connection and rebuilding and healing process to be done. So that in that case she selected this deconstructivism, and like Matthew also did the same, the process of fragmentation or fracturing fractured pieces and then reconnecting everything again. Like that, some selected expressionism like Joris and Kartika, who selected deconstructivism. So both these sides were added. On one side is the emotion, and on other side is how a style or ism can represent that particular emotion. So that is about the form development, but they were we were interested more in the design of spaces. Before that, I'll just explain this project, which is of which is a really interesting thought by George. What he did was like his project actually responded to that axial geometry of central vista. So his concept is like the new normality or what we are going through is just like a tremor in that linearity or linear geometry. So like what how an earthquake is recorded in a seismograph, his project is his design is based on that tremor or the seismographic waves. That is how he represented this new normal, and that is how he responded to that context. And in that itself, he gave a slit opening in the center to respect that axial geometry. So that is how different students conceived this react or fight to the COVID situation. And then coming to the spatial design or design of interior spaces and the interconnections. Then again, they started working on various emotional journeys. So how they conceived the effect of corona on life. One is by Haifa, her emotional cycle is like the birth of corona, the panic and pandemic, facts versus fallacy, the silver lining, from hope to hopeless. So there is a clear emotional pathway, and each emotion is represented by a like spatial design. For example, when you show the silver lining or a hope, they actually combine the light and shadows and the verticality. So they used all these design elements to represent that particular emotion in that space. Then another by Shyamjit, what he did is like a sudden break or opening in a brick wall. So how that is how he represented the impact of corona, because it is set in the axial linear pathway. Then this by sorry. The on the side by Vandana, this one, it is very interesting to see how they started thinking about scales and like materials, the impact of emotional impact of materials. Like this is in the same building. When they use a like here, it is a huge space and related to the human scale. This is in the human scale, and when a person is between the two parallel walls, and if it is in a place with a coordinate place, like when they use different materials, these are all in the same design, but the emotion or effect created by these different spaces is different. So they started actually thinking about the space and volume and the scale and its effect on human beings. These are some other images. Like Tessie ma'am said before, this started thinking about the staircase, the effect of like all kind of staircase. You can see like narrow, very wide, curved, then a combination of both, and a staircase with a bell inside that. So you can see all kind of combinations in the same design. And the effect of like going up and down is different. So it is like you can see all like the effect of staircase is different. And they have used staircase as a major design element. Now another addition is that the very interesting sections could be found. Like rather than ending up with very like typical sections, and normally that happens in design studios. So this time they came up with very interesting sections, and they use the levels. They use various levels and that too with a meaning. These are some other spaces, like the each space like expressing a different thought, like the frozen tunnel, or an auditorium with split opening. It is kind of a very big open space with slit openings. And this is like how we represent a pathway through panic situation. And this is like by Mehsum, what he did is like he used the red brick to respond, red cladding to respond to the context. And the name of the people who were dead in COVID were written on these walls. So like that, they tried every option to represent that particular emotion in that in a space. So these are some other interior spaces. I think these images like self-explanatory, how they represent the hope, and in the play of like light and shadow, and including elements, including the effect of including still water and moving water in a particular space. So each space is actually expressing a particular emotional journey. this is drastic or a magical corridor kind of thing, using light and shadows. And they became more aware about the effect of verticality and horizontality in design. What the verticality represent and what the horizontality represent, and how it respond to the context. That is, in this case, a vertical element respond to the axial geometry. And in this case, it is a slit opening that respond to the axial geometry of the Rajpath. Everything is not like easy as presented. We face a lot of issues. One thing was like the software literacy issue, because some students were like, they got the laptops and all bit late, so they couldn't learn softwares to render the whole design. So even though they came up with very good story, like the student each space is designed with a different emotion, but she could only think in the 2D level or a plan level. And here also this student also, she came up with a variety of emotions and spaces, but she couldn't express it in a 3D way. So that happened due to the online class was one problem. Then the drafting skills, actually this studio, we emphasize more on the conceptual part. So we didn't emphasize much on the drafting part. The technical drawings were required, but the structure and everything is like given a second place. Then the digital glitches, like network and infrastructure issues faced by many students. But ultimately we came up with a few learnings or conclusions. So the whole studio, the first point is like, once we start personalizing certain studio projects, this actually helps improving the students' involvement in this particular studio. For example, when we ask them to write their own story, they all participated. They all did, because they all had a unique story to tell. Each story is different. And we did it in the beginning itself, this created a sort of involvement or interest from the students. Second is like, when we started consciously introducing emotions to particular space, the students started thinking about the spatial quality. What is the effect of light and shadow? What is the effect of scale? And when we change the material, how it affect the space? They started thinking about all kind of experiments and how it affect the spatial quality. So normally an exhibition space come with a box or a particular shape, where they simply some materials are placed to exhibit. But in this case, these exhibition spaces actually represented what the exhibit is representing. Okay, so there is an emotional connection between the exhibit and the exhibition space. Third is like infusing style or rhythm in conceptual stage itself. This helps actually the student in creating meaningful form. You could see all kind of forms, the distorted or deconstructive, all kind of form, but they all carry a meaning. Rather than it is not just for visual seduction or something, they all carry a meaning. So once they understood how and why these styles came up, they started using it with a meaning. And then the last is like including a variety of studio projects and giving considerable weightage to each of these small projects. They can help even the majority of medium performing students to also involve in the studio, and they performed actually better than what is expected from them. I'm actually sad that I couldn't present all the students' works. I included maximum works. Around 98% of the class performed better than what is expected from them based on their previous studio performance. I believe all this our experiments somehow helped them in performing better. So that is it. If you have some questions to ask or something to some suggestions, like how to improve your better.
You can put your questions in the chat box as well if you're not, asking it. So that was a really impressive presentation and really impressive studio work. Congratulations, Architect Ambly and Architect Tessie. You guys can ask your questions now. If there are any more questions, I will ask Anushali to say the word of thanks.
Yes, ma'am. On behalf of Mohammad Sata KJ Academy of Architecture, we have a question.
You have a question? We have a couple of questions here.
Yeah.
First one is from Architect Pallavi D. Did you need to demonstrate the end product to any student?
I didn't got the question actually.
Architect Ambly or Tessie, you can answer this. Did you need to demonstrate the end product to any student?
Actually, we didn't understand the question. End product of what?
So, end product of this experiment, as in we have presented it here. So, the students have, I believe, Architect Pallavi ma'am is asking is, did you give them a guideline of what is expected of them?
No.
A sample of
that. They developed and actually we were also very surprised at the end of the studio that we could and they could also achieve so much. And no, we didn't actually give them anything of what was expected of them. Because one more thing was that the previous design studio, that was S4, that is the even semester, when the COVID had actually hit us, they didn't have a design jury exam also. So we were like, maybe this semester might not also have, but because the project was also interesting and everything, I think that led to the completion of the project much more better. So we didn't actually demonstrate anything, nothing. They led the project.
Okay. I hope that was I think that's all about the questions. Anushali, please continue.
Yes, ma'am. On behalf of Mohammad Sata KJ Academy of Architecture, a heartfelt thanks to Architect Tessie Vakye and Architect Ambly for taking us through emotions in architecture. Very thought-provoking and a very interesting subject indeed. Like how emotions can be triggered through basic geometric shapes and can be even more emphasis through the essence in architecture is truly amazing and overwhelming. I would also like to thank the management for arranging this annual lecture series. Special thanks to Architect Ainsley and Ma'am for organizing such a captivating and engaging lecture. Finally, thanks to my fellow listeners for being enthusiastic and attentive till the end. Thank you all.
Thank you.